This video is sponsored by Skillshare, an online learning community with thousands of classes on everything from business all the way to creative writing and design. So given the year we've had, which in many ways hasn't actually ended, now is a better time than ever to turn your attention inward and focus on your own well-being. In case you need a productive distraction from it all, then I can't recommend Skillshare enough. No matter what you're looking for, Skillshare is bound to have a class that covers it. But in case you need a suggestion, I'm going to recommend Portrait Photography, Shoot and Edit Instagram-Worthy Shots by Jessica Cabasi. The first 1,000 people to use a link in my description box will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium, and after that it's only about 10 bucks a month. Thank you so much to Skillshare for sponsoring this episode, and with that said, let's begin. Honolulu is a city with a small town spirit. Everyone knows each other, and when something happens within the community, you're unlikely to find someone who hasn't caught wind of the situation one way or another. This dynamic became especially apparent when the corpse of a woman by the name of Lisa Au was discovered in the mountainous area of Talus Drive. Something especially shocking to locals, given that it's something you don't see every day. To many, this seemed like a story more likely to come out of the US mainland, and as such, the case created panic throughout the city and the entire island for that matter. What made the situation even worse was the public's certainty that a policeman had somehow been involved in Lisa's slaying. Before we get into that though, we'll have to start at the beginning. The last night, Lisa Au was seen alive. In 1982, Lisa Au was just 19 years old and employed as a hairdresser in her hometown of Kailua on Oahu's east side. Anyone looking in from the outside would assume that all was going well for her. On top of being employed, Lisa was also dating her boyfriend, a University of Hawaii student by the name of Doug Holmes. On the night of January 20th, Lisa and Doug planned to meet up, specifically at Doug's sister's apartment in the town of Makiki. At 9:45 p.m., Lisa wrapped up at the Kailua salon and set out, first making a brief stop at a grocery store to pick up snacks for the gathering before continuing to her destination, which she reached shortly thereafter. By 12:20 a.m., the gathering disbanded, the meeting being oddly brief for reasons we'll speculate on shortly. Lisa was now on her way back to Kailua, while Doug was on his way back to his UH dorm room. Or at least, that was the plan. Lisa never made it back to Kailua. In fact, her roommate happened to still be up that night expecting to see Lisa back, and when she failed to show up, the roommate began to worry. Both the authorities and Lisa's parents were contacted, and by the next morning, the Au family had got in touch with Lisa's boyfriend to ask him what was going on. After all, he was the last person to see their daughter. Doug claimed to know nothing and volunteered to be the first to go out and search for his now missing girlfriend. The obvious place to start would be Lisa's side of the island, and that's where Doug happened upon a disturbing discovery. Lisa's car was abandoned on the side of the road, and was described as having a window partially rolled down with the interior soaking wet. Lisa's purse was located in one of the seats, which wasn't something most would expect to find. Surely Lisa would have taken it with her if she'd gone somewhere else, and if this was some kind of robbery, well, then it still probably would not have been there. The only thing of note that was missing was Lisa's ID card. Following this disturbing discovery, the entire island of Oahu would come to know Lisa's name. Posters and flyers were placed just about everywhere, and everyone had their eyes peeled. But as the days went by, the picture began to grow more and more grim. How does someone go missing on an island where everyone is looking for you? In the event that said person isn't found immediately, then you can begin to assume the worst. And that's unfortunately exactly what happened here. On January 31st, roughly 10 days after Lisa disappeared, her nude corpse was located by a man walking his dog along Talus Drive. For context, Talus is up in the mountains and heavily wooded, not to mention pitch black at night. This isn't the kind of place Lisa would have ended up at by mistake, especially considering the fact that it was completely off course from her route and miles away from where her car was discovered. Now, as I said a second ago, Lisa's disappearance was already alarming enough, but the fact that she'd been murdered and her body abandoned sent shockwaves throughout the local community. To make matters even worse, they were left to speculate since there were barely any answers coming from up top. Due to varying factors, including decomposition, Lisa's cause of death couldn't even be determined and to this day still remains a mystery. Her abandoned car wasn't much help either as far as forensics went. There was close to nothing to work with. The best anyone could do was rely on witnesses and tips, and as people began to come forward, a horrifying theory would dominate the narrative surrounding this case. People began to talk, and rumors began to spread based on a few testimonies where residents of the island claim to have been harassed or attacked by people who appeared to be police officers. Now, what do I mean by that? At the time, HPD had been using a number of unmarked police cars, only identifiable via blue lights mounted on their grills, something that was actually discontinued in response to Lisa's case. As such, it was difficult to be sure who was trying to stop you at night. It could have been an actual officer or just someone posing as one to lure women into a false sense of security. This theory was also compounded by a small detail about the state of Lisa's car. As I mentioned, Lisa's ID was missing and her window rolled down. To many, this signaled that the young woman had been stopped by either an actual cop or someone she thought was one. It's believed that she rolled down her window, handed this person her ID, and then was abducted. This theory is one that most probably never see gaining any traction, not necessarily due to its viability, but because, as we all know, it's incredibly difficult to convince the legal system to go after police, even when it's entirely justified and even necessary, which is one of the things that makes this case so different. Following a witness testimony, a local police officer was actually called out by name as the person who stopped Lisa and possibly murdered her, and soon said officer was under full investigation. Both the state and local PD didn't seem too concerned about protecting one of their own, something that tends to not be seen very often. To many, this development seemed promising, and perhaps to the public even felt comforting. But not everyone was convinced. The Owl family hired ex-HPD homicide Lieutenant Burt Cornell as a private investigator, and what made Cornell especially relevant here is that he was actually the man in charge of Lisa's case at the time it reached the department. And on top of this, the former officer felt that the investigation had been botched for a number of reasons, mainly stuff that basic investigating could have debunked. For example, the whole crux of the killer cop and/or cop impersonator theory hinged upon Lisa's missing ID. For a long time, that ID was integral to this case, but it turns out that it was actually later located. If you'll recall, I mentioned that Lisa stopped at a grocery store to pick up snacks before heading off to meet Doug at the Makiki apartment. That type of seemingly trivial information would normally be left omitted from stories like this, but in this case, it was left in for a reason. While at the grocery store, Lisa wrote a check, which is a thing we humans used to do. It required an ID, one she simply forgot at the cash register. Now, this doesn't necessarily disprove anything. This case is still unsolved to this day, and by all means, it still could have been a cop or impersonator who was responsible. But only looking at one person of interest would just be foolish. And to add to this angle, the so-called witness who named the officer as a suspect was actually pulled over herself the night of Lisa's disappearance for supposed erratic driving. But it's not confirmed that she actually saw the officer interact with Lisa. So where do we go from here? As part of his private investigation, Detective Cornell also interviewed various witnesses that HPD seemed to have overlooked. One of them being a man by the name of Thomas Thornburg, the security guard working the Makiki apartment where Lisa was last seen alive. According to him, he saw the couple arguing that night at around 11 p.m., just an hour and a half before everyone went their separate ways. Maybe this was the reason why the meeting was so short, but either way, this brings us to a much more obvious person of interest, Lisa's own boyfriend. Spouses and romantic partners are always looked at first whenever a homicide takes place, but for whatever reason, HPD seemed completely uninterested in Doug Holmes. Keep in mind, he wasn't just the last person to see this woman alive, but also the one who found her car and had an argument with her the night before. Of course, that's not to say he wasn't investigated at all. He was, and was even issued 2 polygraph tests, both of which he failed while still maintaining his innocence. Lie detectors, of course, are not a perfect science, but you'd assume that, especially back then, this would have raised some questions. When asked about his results, Doug claimed that he failed due to guilt, that he felt bad about what happened to Lisa. For whatever reason, the HPD thought that this was perfectly reasonable and also claimed that they couldn't see Doug having any motivation to hurt Lisa. The final bit of relevant information in regards to this case comes from a witness by the name of Charlotte Kamaka, who happened to be driving along Tantalus the night Lisa went missing. She claimed it was then she witnessed a man in a blue car along with a woman in the passenger seat who seemed to be unconscious. Who this mystery man was is unknown, and whether or not this was Lisa is still unverified, although it seems entirely plausible. Even so, without a plate number or pictures, this testimony didn't do much. And that's really the frustration surrounding this case. All avenues have led to dead ends, and it feels like those in charge were more worried about publicly pinning down a suspect rather than capturing the actual killer. In the end, Doug Holmes was never arrested in relation to the Lisa Au case, and a grand jury failed to indict the accused officer. The Honolulu Star Bulletin probably summarized this case best when they described it as being, quote, hampered by internal tensions within the Honolulu Police Department, inadequate autopsy work on the body, and perhaps ultimately, resentment by police of a private detective's work on the case for the Au family. This video was edited by Darkfire Productions, researched by Lux Noctis, with writing and additional research by yours truly. Support for this episode and the channel overall comes from the following lovely people on Patreon. T. Gorman, Connor H., Base of Shadow, W.H., Zuicha Zales, Ronnie, T.B.F., Saul A., Michelle G., Guilty Pleasures, Corey Barks, David G., Catherine L., K.M., B.K. Ketchup, P.D.G., Astro, Tyler T., Bloody the Elf, Amelia J., Andrew L., Esper Nix, Sean, C.H.B., Eric M., Brandon F., Val C., Danielle G., A.J. Runaway, Corey W., Lance Ulysses, Daniel P., Mega Brutal, Sean C., Eddie, Terry the Outlaw, Sebastian N., Jace, Kyle R., Layla R., Bath Time Duck, Zimbledorf the Calzone Consumer, Rye S, Francisco B, Sky Grinder, It's Mitt, YOLO for Jesus, Luck B, Scorian S, Benjamin M, Nick B, Melody, S, PC, Zippo, Keith Z, Matt J, James M, Zerai, and Tiago P. Thank you all so much for your support, and I'll see you all again soon.